Okay, so let's have a look at the static power issues for our VLSI circuits. Okay, so static power is consumed when the chip is in the quiescent state. So quiescent state means that device is off, not operating. Okay, not really off. The power is still on. We can say not operating. Okay, no switching. So the leakage draws power from a nominally off devices. Okay, nominally off means not operating. Ratchet circuits burn power in fight between the on transistors. Okay, let's look at the concept of the leakage or the static power consumption. So in the leakage here, it is shown that we have two types of leakage. So we have a leakage current from the gate and goes to ground. So normally we say that we have a very high or ideally it's an infinite resistance at the gate. Remember we have the oxide, we have the gate oxide. So normally the current cannot flow through. But at small VT, especially at small the threshold voltage, then you're gonna have a current going through the gate and that is called leakage. Okay, so the current is leaking from the gate all the way to ground. You also have a drain leakage. So here remember we have the drain. So from the drain diffusion, the active area of the drain, we have the drain leakage that goes all the way to ground. So we actually lose some current to ground, and that loss of current is called the leakage current. Okay, but it's usually very very small compared to the dynamic current. Sub threshold current is a dominant factor. So this one here, this guy here is a dominant from the drain to ground, and all increases especially with temperature. So this sub threshold is in the condition when the NMOS is off. Okay, so the NMOS is off, there's supposed to be no current flow going down, but in fact there is a very little current. But as temperature increase, we also increase the sub threshold current. Leakage is a function of threshold voltage. Okay, so we've seen already, we've talked a little bit on how the threshold voltage will impact the speed and the power, and especially the leakage on the power side. Continuous scaling of supply voltage and the subsequent scaling of threshold will make sub-threshold conduction a dominant component of power dissipation. Okay, so let's see the graph here. So VGS, a threshold voltage, let's say a threshold voltage of 0.1. So if it's a threshold voltage of 0.1, we are looking at this one. Okay, you can look at this guy. So we can see that actually sub threshold, so less than here is VT is less than 0.1. Okay, so the threshold voltage, VGS VGS is less than 0.1. So VGS less than 0.1, the device should be off. But in fact, there is some current. Okay, so here is your sub threshold conduction current. Okay, so similarly here, when VGS is less than 0.4, we have some current. Okay, we have some current flowing through, which is not what we want. Okay, we don't want any leakage, if possible. But you can see the values are extremely small. Okay, in the case of the VGS 0, okay, is almost 10 to the minus 11. Okay, so let's have a look at the TSMC process leakage and the threshold voltage. So we can see here, for this is a 0.18, okay, so this is a 0.18 micron technology. This is a 0.13 micron technology, and you can see that the VDD is decreasing. This is the oxide thickness. So the oxide thickness is also quite important, because if you have a thinner, smaller oxide, then most likely you're gonna have more leakage. Okay, more leakage there. This is the gate length. Okay, the gate length, the saturation current, and this is the leakage in picoamp. Okay, so it is quite small. Okay, but still, as we go on, the factor increase quite a lot, and that is why I believe we have some reliability issues when we use a very advanced technology. Because one instance is, you know, for example, our leakage is relatively big, but it's not that big, but it's relatively big compared to the other technology. So the threshold voltage, you can see, dropped almost half, going to the 0.13. But what we gain from a small VT is actually our performance. So the transistor can switch much faster. Okay, it can switch much faster, mainly because our threshold voltage is small. So even though our VDD is small, threshold is small, we are able to get a much faster, better performance. But power might be impacted somewhat. Exponential increase in leakage current. So let's have a look in the how the leakage is impacted by temperature. So this is in C, okay, in degrees Celsius. So in normal temperature, it's not impacted so much, okay, in room temperature. But if you go to the oven temperature, for example, okay, the oven temperature, you can see that your leakage will be increased. And increase seems to be quite exponentially there. Okay, here you have a log scale. Okay, you have a log scale there, so it increases quite high. Okay, as we go to the oven temperature. Leakage control. So how do we control our leakage? Leakage and delay trade-off. So aim for low leakage in the sleep mode, and low delay in the active mode. So that's what we aim. When we are not using the device, when it's a standby. We want to have a low leakage, and when we're using it, we want to have a fast performance. So it's all about controlling your threshold voltage, and that's why nowadays it's quite common, as far as I know, that in practice people use multiple threshold voltage in the chip. So some part of the chip might use small VT and some part high VT. Okay, so low VT. So remember that low VT is low VT good speed. Okay, and then high VT good power. Okay, so if there's a part that you want a good leakage control, you want to have a high VT. If you need speed, then you want to go for low VT. Okay. So the way we control it, we can control by looking at the reverse bias, the body voltage, okay, the VB. The VB will determine basically our threshold voltage. Okay, the gate leakage, so extremely strong function of TOX and VGS. Negligible for all the process, approach sub-threshold location at 65 nanometer and below in some process. An order of magnitude less for PMOS than NMOS. Control location in the process using TOX greater than 10.5 angstrom. High K gate dielectrics help. Some process provide multiple TOX. Control leakage in circuits by limiting VDD. So gate leakage is not really the main issue previously. But in the current, in the newer process, yes, you have it. But still the sub-threshold still dominates the leakage. Junction leakage. Okay, junction leakage, you talk about the leakage on the drain junction. Okay, on the drain terminal of the design. So from reverse bias PN junction between diffusion and substrate, ordinary diode leakage is negligible. Band to band tunneling can be significant, especially in high VT transistors where other leakage is small. Worse at VDV equals to VDD. Gate induced drain leakage exacerbates. Worse for VGD equals to negative VDD. So these are some of the issues with the junction leakage. Not going to go through in detail. Power gating, okay, similar to the clock gating. So we seen the clock gating previously. So power gating, the idea is to turn off the power to blocks when they are idle to save leakage. Okay, so when we know that the block is not in use, we can simply don't provide VDD. Okay, don't provide VDD to block. So this is what it's trying to do here. So we can see here. Okay, in the sleep mode. So if you put one on the sleep, so then here will be zero. So your VDD is zero when you put sleep equals to one. And here is called the virtual VDD. Okay, the virtual VDD is not connected to directly to your main VDD. The gate output to prevent invalid logic levels to the next block, so you have some control here for the output isolation. Voltage drop across the slip transistor degrades performance during normal operation. Size the transistor wide enough to minimize the impact. So it's not so easy actually to design these slip transistors. So there's a challenge to it. How do you want to design it? Because it's actually not that straightforward that you can put any transistor you want. There are some issues that you need to be aware of when designing the slip transistors. Switching wide slip transistor costs a dynamic power, only justified when circuit sleeps long enough. So this is another the issue that if you know that the circuit will sleep long enough, then it might be suitable or feasible to implement the power gating. Okay, if not, there might be some issue with the dynamic power when you try to switch it on. Okay, so we finished with the static, okay, the static power, and now we're gonna go back and look into detail on the dynamic power, okay, the switching dynamic power. Okay, so let's do some analysis here on the dynamic power. So switching activity, we go back to this. So if you remember that our dynamic power consumption, our dynamic power consumption is simply CL, VDD squared, P0 to 1, and F. Okay, and we have this component P0 to 1. So what is P0 to 1? So P0 has two components. It has a static component, function of the logic topology, and a dynamic component with the function of the timing behavior called the glitching. So the static transition probability P01 is actually the probability that the node is in logic 0 multiplied with the probability that the node is in logic 1. So this is for the inverter, I believe. P0, oh sorry, so this is for the 2 input NOR. Okay, so for the P input NOR, we have the static transition probability P0 times 1 minus P0. Okay, so with input signal probability PA equals to 1 is 1 over 2, and PB equals to 1 equals to 1 over 2. Okay, so we see on the input here, okay, we have equal probability that is in logic 1. Okay, so this is 2 over 4. Okay, so 2 over 4 we have so the probability that the input is logic 1 is 1 over 2, and the probability that the input B is logic 1 is also 1 over 2. So that's what we can get here. The NOR static transition probability is therefore 3 over 4 times 1 over 4 equals to 3 over 16. So this one is the probability, so this is P out 1. Okay, P out 1. P out equals to 1 equals to 1 over 4. Okay, because it's only 1. So the probability is 35%. Okay, of probability that the output of the NOR gate is equals to logic 1. And P out 0 is equals to 3 over 4. Okay, so 1 to 3 over 4. So if you multiply this together, 3 over 4 multiply with 1 over 4, you get 3 over 16. And 3 over 16 is your P01 for the 2 input NOR gate. Okay, assuming that the AB is 0.5. Okay, but the AB input can be different. This is based on the truth table. This is what is called the static transition probability, which means that we assume we're looking at the truth table, but in actual case, the data that comes into your gate is not. It might not be 50% logic 1. Okay, so let's look at further here. So the switching activity is a strong function of the input signal statistics. PA and PB are the probabilities that inputs A and B are 1. Okay, so that's the definition. PA, PB is a probability that the inputs A, B are 1. And statically is 1 over 4, but dynamically it can be different. So then we have here is P01 is P0 times 1, P1, so the probability at 0 and polarity at 1 is 1 minus 1 minus PA, 1 minus PB, 1 minus PA, 1 minus PB. So you can detail here. So let's see the transition probabilities of some basic gates. Okay, so we've seen already for the two input NOR. Okay, for the NOR gate, we have this guy here. Okay. So the probability of this is the probability of the output of the NOR is equals to 0. Okay. So we have two parts here. So we have one part. So here is P out equals to 1, and this side here is P out equals to 0. Okay. So P out equals to 0 multiply P out equals to 1, we have the P 0 to 1. Okay, so this is a very important table. Okay, very important table to understand. For example, for the AND gate, so this guy here, PA PB, is the P out 1. Okay, and then this guy here is P out 0. Okay. So from here we can say that given the probability of the input A and the probability of logic 1 on input A, the probability of logic 1 on input B, we can then use this equation to calculate what is our switching activity factor, the probability that the output transition from 0 to 1 for a particular gate. Okay, so let's have a look at the example here. We have assuming we have this is PA and PB. So the probability of input A equals to 1 is 0.5. The probability of input B equals to 1 is also 0.5. So then we say that because it's an inverter, so for inverter is simply the probability at the output X is simply P0 P1. So the probability at X, so you can say the probability at X, okay, on the output is just it's basically PA 1 minus PA. Okay, so here is just 0.5 times 0.5. Okay, so PA is 0.5, 1 minus 0.5 is also 0.5, so your PX here is 0.25. Okay, so we have a PX PB, and for Z is an AND gate, the output is an AND gate. So for AND gate, we can see that this is your equation here. Okay, and what is your PA PB? So for this guy, your PA is equals to PX and your PB is equals to PB. Okay, and then you use this equation, so you can see that it's 1 minus PX PB multiply with PX PB, which is simply this equation here. Okay, 1 minus PX. Okay, so if you do this calculation, you are going to get 3 over 16 as your switching activity factor. Okay, it's your switching activity factor. So your P01 here is actually 3 over 16. Okay. So logic restructuring, changing the topology of a logic network to reduce the transition. So for an AND gate, we have the P01, which is equal to this, based on our table for an AND gate. So let's compare. This is the same logic. Okay, we have a 1, 2, 3, 4 input AND. Okay, we want to implement a 4 input AND gate, and we want to calculate what is our switching activity factor at every node. Okay, and remember our power is CL VDD squared P0 to 1F. So assuming we have the same CLB squared F, then our power now mainly going to depend on P01. So in order to calculate power, Our dynamic power, we need to find what is our switching activity P01. Yes, and once we find P01, then we can calculate our power. Okay, so what is our P01 at every output node? Okay, so let's first calculate what is our P01 at W. Okay, so then here we have PW. Okay, so this is an AND gate. So PW is just 1 minus PAPB. Okay, times PAPB. So this one is okay, so in fact this is P01W. Okay, so this is P021W, let's put like this. So the switching activity factor at node W is given because of the AND gate. We're looking at the table, is given by this, but your PW is the probability that node W is 1, which is not the same as P01W. Okay, so the probability of PW equals to 1 is simply this guy, okay, which is PAPB. Okay, so this one is calculated here. Okay, so this is 3/16. But your PW, okay, the probability that node W is 1 is just 0.25. Okay, it is 0.25. Okay, so let's look at x. So P01 of x, and this is also an AND gate, so it's 1 minus PAPB. It's an AND gate. Okay, so this one, so our PA is here. Okay, our PA is PW, so it's 1 minus PWPC. Okay, PWPC. And our PW is here, 0.25. So if we do this, is in fact 1 minus PW is 0.25. Okay, so 1 over 2, 1 over 4. Okay, 0.25, 1 over 5. And then 1 over 2, 1 over 4. Okay, so we should have 7 over 64 as our switching activity is a P01X. Okay, so this one is 1 over 8. So this is 7 over 8 times 1 over 8 equals to 7 over 64, and this is our 7 over 64 there. But remember, our PX is different. So our PX is the probability that the node X is equal to logic 1, okay, which is simply PAPB. PAPB, which is equals to PWPC, which is equals to 0.25 times 0.5, which is equals to 1 over 8. Okay, so PX, so it's easy to get confused between P01W and PW, P01X and PX, and remember that if there's no 0 to 1, it means that the probability that the node is going to take a logic 1, which is, if you look at the table, is on the right side. Okay, on the right side of the equation. And your P01 is 1 minus the right side, because your P01 is the probability that the node is 0 multiplied with the probability that the node is equals to 1. Okay, so if you do all the same, then you can see that actually we get a switching activity factor at W is 3 over 16. Okay, 3 over 16, 7 over 64, 15 over 256. And on the right side, the switching activity factor is 3 over 16, 3 over 16, 15 over 256. So then we can calculate what is our average, or what is our total activity factor between these two, and which one is less. Okay, so which one is less? So let's, it's getting quite messy. Let's go to the slide. Okay, so it says here that, chain implementation has a lower overall switching activity than the tree implementation for random input. However, delay performance suffers. Okay, so here, less total switching activity. Okay, this is more activity. Okay, so you can see the same functionality, but the switching activity is actually more. So when you have more switching activity, you are going to consume more power. But if you analyze this, you can see that on the right side of the circuit is faster. Only two stage logic, generally is faster, okay, compared to the left one. Okay, so input ordering also can impact the power. So if you do A and B and C, and if you know the probability of logic one on the inputs, then you want to restructure so that the higher probability of logic one on the AND gate, okay, at least on the AND gate, must be at the later stage in your circuit. Okay, for example, here you have a 0.5. Okay, so A has a higher probability that it's logic one, and you want to put at the end of the gate compared to the other ones. Okay, so here you can do the same. You can actually calculate what is your this is your P01. So this is your P01X. Okay, your P01X, your activity at X is 0.09. Okay, and remember, this is the probability of the node going from 0 to 1. Okay. Okay, and we can see here, if you do like this, you are going to get a switching activity factor of at X is only 0.0196. And it actually makes sense. Okay, it actually makes sense because for an AND gate, if you have more zeros, okay, if you have more zero in your input, then you'll have less switching. Okay, so B and C here, the probability of 1 is 20% and 10%, so most likely your X will not be switching too much, okay, compared to the to this guy, okay, 0.5 and 2. So you have more switching on the X, so you want to have less switching for an AND gate. Okay, for an AND gate, for a different gate it might be different. So it's basically beneficial to postpone the introduction of signals with a high transition rate, signal probability close to 0.5. Switching power is a function of VDD. So the decreasing the VDD decreases the switching energy consumption, but increases the gate delay. So here is quite interesting to see what happened to our switching power, okay, the SC, and we see that the SC actually decreased with VDD. Determine the critical path at the other time and use high VDD for transistors on those paths for speed. Use a low VDD on other gates, especially those that drive large capacitors, as this yields the largest energy benefit. So this is one of the design strategies that you can use. Again, if you need high speed, go for high VDD. But if you don't need it, then you go for low VDD. What about multiple VDD consideration? I think we've talked about this in the previous slides. So many chips already have two supplies, multiple domain. So I think I'm going to skip this one. Dual supply inside the logic block. Dual supply, okay, so this is a dual supply. Some of the issues with dual supply is the minimum energy consumption is achieved if all logic paths are critical, clustered voltage scaling. Each path starts with VDH and switches with VDL. Level conversion is done in the flip-flop at the end of the path. So you can see that here is a different domain. Okay, different VDD, and you have to be careful when you are switching between the voltage domain. There might be some power issue when translating, or maybe you are not translating correctly. You are not going to get the logic level that you want. Leakage is a function of VT. I think we've seen this already in the previous slide. Let's skip this. Dual threshold inside a logic block. I'm going to skip this. I think we go straight to the conclusion. Okay, no conclusion there. Okay, so variable VT at runtime. Okay, so I think we already see this already in the previous slide as well, I think. So the VT can be varied at runtime by just modifying the VSB, right? The source to bulk can have different VT to control the speed and power. Okay, based on our requirements. Okay, so I think that's it. That's it for this part of the lecture, and I think we are done with the course. So this should be the last page for the course, and okay, so we are done with it.